So we are going today deal with the operational amplifiers. So an operational amplifier is a linear integrated circuit, an integrated circuit with very high voltage gain and high input impedance and very low output impedance. So it is a linear integrated circuit with very high voltage gain, high input impedance, and very low output impedance. The high input impedance is to limit the noise at the input terminals while the low output impedance is to avoid overloading the amplifier. By feeding maximum output to the load. So we're going to have a sketch of the operational amplifier, and so that we are able to know the terminals. We're able to know the terminals and the connections that can be made on a operational amplifier. So this is how the symbol looks like. So this is the inverting. This is non-inverting terminal. This is the inverting terminal. And this is the positive supply. This is the negative supply, and this is the output. Timing. So generally, we need to understand why we are talking about the non-inverting. What non-inverting refers to? The inverting refers to the positive supply, refers to negative ground, faithful, and the output terminal. When we're talking about the non-inverting terminal, we are talking about a terminal that reproduces the same shape of the signal. The inverting terminal is that it's able to phase shift the input signal to be in the opposite way in the representation. But all the same, when we have these two terminals, the normally there are the input terminals. The two terminals here are normally referred to the input terminals. This is what we refer to that as the input terminals. So another thing you need to understand is that the amplifiers can operate from both the positive and the negative voltage, depending on the areas of application. So when you have this, then the positive terminal and the negative terminal are normally connected respectively with respect to the ground. So the output, you take it through the output terminal to the next point of termination. So we're going to do to deal with now characteristics of the operational amplifier. Characteristics of operational amplifiers or pumps. We have seen one from even the definition is high open loop voltage gain. Another characteristic we have here is a high input impedance. Another characteristic we have there is the low output impedance. Another characteristic we have here is zero offset voltage. Another characteristic we have there is the common mode rejection ratio. Common mode rejection ratio. We may refer to as CMRR. Another characteristic we have there is input offset voltage. And the last one that I might put here is the slew rate. So there are several characteristics, and they're not limited to seven that we're going to discuss a few here. So when you have this, this what is now going to guide us. When we're talking about the high open loop voltage gain, is that we're talking about the gain when there's no feedback. And that gain is extremely infinite, it's very big. And because of that, we are able to use the amplifier for the purpose of improving the amplitude. The high input impedance is basically to limit the input noise at the input terminals, so that the amplification process doesn't amplify noise. The low output impedance is to prevent the heating, the internal heating of the amplifier, so that the heat generated or the power generated is directly dissipated to the external load. And by so doing, we shall create, we're using the linear region of the amplifier as required. Then you have this zero offset voltage. The meaning of zero offset voltage is that there should be no output voltage appearing at the output terminals when there's no input signal. In other words, the amplifier should perform its work faithfully by actually amplifying an input that is present and not giving us an output when there's no input. So zero offset voltage means that there should be no output when there's no input. Another thing, talking of the common mode rejection ratio. The meaning of common mode is that at times you are going to realize that at the inverting and the non-inverting terminals, the signals are of the same, and that's of the same format and the same amplitudes. So the purpose of the common mode rejection ratio is that when the amplifier detects that the signals are similar at the inverting and the non-inverting terminal, it's supposed to mute, it's supposed to reject that one. The amplifier then fails to amplify the signals that are common. Remember, we're talking about an amplifier that operates on a differential mode gain. The differential mode gain is that the amplifier is going to amplify only when the input at the inverting and the non-inverting terminals exist. The input offset voltage then requires that we should not get an output when the input is zero. The slew rate is the rate at which the output changes with respect to the input. When the output changes with respect to the input, then we are talking about the slew rate, as normally expressed in terms of voltage per meter second, because we talk of the change in the output with respect to the input. So we are going to have several discussions on how amplifiers are used in terms of the applications. So we're going to talk about analysis of operational amplifier circuits. Basically, this is how the amplifiers can be used in different applications, and we want to analyze on several applications of this. So the first one we are going to talk about is the inverting amplifier. Inverting amplifier. So you have to sketch that one. So this is an example of an inverting amplifier diagram. And when you look at this diagram, we have the feedback resistor and have the input resistor. At the other end, we have the input voltage, and at the end of the output voltage. So because of the high input impedance, very little current is going to flow through the inverting terminal. And the assumption is that the current flowing through the input resistor, the same current that's going to flow through the output resistor or the feedback resistor. So when you have that, then you're talking about the inverting amplifier, the op-amp as an inverting amplifier. So from Kirchhoff's voltage law, from Kirchhoff's current law, then I of the input current is supposed to be minus I of the feedback current. But we all know that the input current is given by VR over R of I. It's supposed to be minus VO over R of F. By rearranging this so that we have our condition given as VO over V of I is supposed to be minus R of F over R of I. And this is supposed to give us the closed gain. So by expressing the ratio as the gain, the gain is only expressed as in terms of the output voltage over the input voltage. By expressing that, when you have that, you now deduce that our closed loop gain is supposed to be minus Rf over R of I. So this is what we need to know. When we go to analysis number two, is the non-inverting amplifier. And you also hope to have a sketch of this.
So this example of a non-inverting amplifier diagram, and we need to understand why we're talking about the non-inverting diagram. When you look at the input voltage, VI, the input voltage VI is grounded. So we need to put this as, this was the input voltage, but it's not, it's the source of the voltage, VI, it's going to the positive terminal, while the output voltage is taken to through the negative terminal and also grounded.
When so look
at that, is that this one is, there's a voltage referred to as the VD. VD is the differential voltage, and it is the voltage that appears across terminal V1 and V2. When the output voltage is taken through an RF with respect to the ground, which is a potentiometer, because RF and RI act as a series resistor. So we tap the terminal there, we talk about the potentiometer. So V2 is a feedback of the
same. So from this situation here, then we know that,
for us to get the input voltage that's going to be at the terminal here, the input voltage then, this one that must go there, must be the difference between the two for the amplification process to be there. So our VI, just a minute. When we go to analysis number two, is the non-inverting amplifier. And you also have to have a sketch of this. So this example of a non-inverting amplifier diagram, and we need to understand why we're talking about the non-inverting diagram. When you look at the input voltage, VI, the input voltage VI is grounded. So we need to put this as, this was the input voltage, but it's not, it's the source of the voltage, VI, it's going to the positive terminal, while the output voltage is taken to through the negative terminal and also grounded.
When so look
at that, is that this one is, there's a voltage referred to as the VD. VD is the differential voltage, and it is the voltage that appears across terminal V1 and V2. So when the output voltage is taken through an RF with respect to the ground, which is a potentiometer, because RF and RI act as a series resistor. So we tap the terminal there, we talk about the potentiometer. So V2 is a feedback of the
same. So from this situation here,
then we know that, we know that for us to get the input voltage that's going to be at the terminal layer, the input voltage, then this one that must go there, must be the difference between the two for the amplification process to be there. So our VI, just a minute. The input voltage, VD, which is the voltage difference, is given as VD is supposed to be V1 minus V2. VD is supposed to be V1 minus V2. But when you look at this, then V1 is approximately the same as VI. V1 is approximately the same as VI. So another thing we need to be aware of is when you're talking about that, then V1 is approximately the same as V1. V1 is approximately the same as VI. And we need to be able to fit this in our expression. And whatever talk as V2. V2 can be a feedback voltage.
So it's also VF. Huh?
We can talk of V2. Then V2, which is the feedback voltage because it's coming from the output, which is also the feedback voltage, can be given as a ratio of the two resistors.
And we're giving this
as a ratio of the two resistors. Then this is acting as a potentiometer.
Then we have to know that
our V2 is supposed to be the ratio R1 over R1 plus R of the feedback resistor multiplied by VO.
So how then do we get the output voltage? In the VO is supposed to be given as the differential voltage. The differential voltage multiplied by the gain. It's
supposed to be VD multiplied by the gain. But what is the differential voltage? V1 minus V2. Then multiplied by the gain. But what is V1? V1 is VI. And what is V2? V2 is R1 over R1 plus R of F multiplied by VO. This one is now multiplied by gain.
Then we
we can now open our brackets. And solve this case very simple. So this is AVI minus R1 VO over R1 plus RF, supposed to be VO. You can collect the like terms together and have a VO plus A R1 VO over R1 plus R of F is supposed to be AVI. You can factorize out here, then you shall have VO into 1 plus A R1 over R1 plus RF. AVI. So we know that what? But close up again. Yeah? Close loop gain it's supposed to be V over VI, which is supposed to be A over 1 plus A R1 over R1 plus R of F. So from the denominator, A Ri or Ri plus Rf. It's R1, not Ri. R1. It's far much greater than 1 when compared. Therefore, closed loop gain is given as VO over VI is supposed to give us A over AR over R AR1 over R one plus R of F. So by simplifying this, this and this is going to cancel, then we shall have this as 1 plus Rf over R of I. So we expect to know that closed loop gain is supposed to be V over VI . So we're going to go to the third application, which is summing amplifier. The summing amplifier, let us have a sketch of that. So this is a sketch of the summing amplifier, and when you look at this diagram, just as the term summer or summing or addition is, we're going to have several inputs at the input end of the operational amplifier, and these inputs combine so that we have the term summing. So at also the output, there's also a feedback resistor. And we talk of this as the feedback current IF, but the respective links and path we have that the I1 and I2 and I3 in the respective resistors. So from Kirchhoff's current law, I1 plus I2 plus I3 is supposed to be minus I of F. But what's I1? I1 is supposed to be V1 over R1 plus this is V2 over R2 plus V3 over R3 is supposed to be minus VO over R of F. So for us to get the output, then we get it as VO is supposed to be minus
RF into Z1 over R1 plus Z2 over R2 plus Z3 over R3. So that's the quiet question.
If a reference voltage is used, if a reference voltage is used to replace the individual voltages at the input terminals, i.e. V ref is supposed to be V1, supposed to be V2, supposed to be V3. V1 supposed to be V2, supposed to be V3. Then the output shall be given as VO is supposed to be minus RF VREF into 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2 plus 1 over R3 plus 1 over R3. For this case, and the gain of the amplifier shall be expressed as the gain of the amplifier shall be expressed as VO over V reference supposed to be minus RF into 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2 plus 1 over R3. So we're going to the fourth application. Integrating amplifier. So we have also have the sketch. When you look at this diagram, is that any time you're talking about the integrating circuit, then the capacitor is connected to the feedback line. So when you look at that diagram, the capacitor is here and there's an input resistor. So it also applies that we also apply the same principle for the current flow and the Kirchhoff's current law. So when you look at this, we're looking at a situation whereby we shall be able to change the rate of the output. When you look at that, then we shall have from Kirchhoff's current law, I equals minus I of F.
But we all know that the input current is supposed to be Vi over R of I, while the current for expression of the feedback current is supposed to be C D V O D T. C V D O D T means that the current that's going to flow as from the capacitor is a function of rate of change of the voltage across the terminals of the capacitor. The voltage across the terminal of the capacitor is the output of voltage. Therefore, we have C D V O is a rate. Dt is the rate of change of the output voltage. That's what is responsible for producing the current through the capacitor. When we have this, then we know that Vi over Ri C of F is supposed to be dVo dt. Then we can separate the variables so that when we write it as Vi over R of I CF dt is supposed to be dVo. dVo. Which implies that for us to get the output, voltage, then we integrate both sides. Then shall have the integral of sine Vi dt or R of I CF. Supposed to be given as integral of dVo, which means that our output voltage is supposed to be the integral of Vi over RICF dt. But RICF is the time constant tau. We shall have our VO is 1 over tau integral of VI dt. We go to the next application, which is application number 5, is differentiator. We also have to draw the diagram. So talking about the differentiator, you have the capacitor at the input. We have the capacitor at the input, which is abbreviated C, and the feedback resistor. So from Kirchhoff's current law, I of the input is equal minus I of F. Then look at this is C dVi dt is supposed to be minus Vo over R of F, which then implies that my Vo is supposed to be minus RFC dVi dt. dVi dt. So this is what we expect. So going to the next application is subtractor. Or what I refer to as a difference amplifier.
as a difference amplifier. And we're going to sketch this.
So that is a differentiator, and in this case we have got two inputs at the same time that are connected through the operational amplifier, and you're also seeing that across the output terminal is an output voltage which is feeding back the voltage at the inverting terminal. So with this kind of analysis, we have to assume first that when there's no either of them, then what is the condition? And when there's both of them are present, then what is the condition? So that we arrive at a familiar formula that is standard. So the first thing we have to assume that one with either of the voltages is absent or zero, then we do the analysis with respect to the individual voltages present. Then we shall start. When the supply voltage V2 is equals to zero, when there's no supply voltage at V2, then the rest of the amplifier will behave like an inverting amplifier. Because if there's a zero voltage at this point, it means that this part of the amplifier will be inactive and shall have the amplifier acting as an inverting amplifier. The amplifier will act as an inverting amplifier. Therefore, a closed loop gain will be given as V1, in this case V1 is present, not VI. V1 supposed to be minus R of F over R1. So we also do the analysis when V1 is approximate to zero with an input at the V2. Then we know what is supposed to be there. So, when V1 is equals to zero, the amplifier will be a non-inverting amplifier. The amplifier will be a non-inverting amplifier. And therefore, the voltage appearing at the positive terminal will be reflected at the inverting terminal. So voltage appearing at the positive terminal, whatever we refer to as the plus terminal in our diagram, then it will be given by the ratio of the two resistors, R3 over R3 plus R2. R3 over R3 plus R2. Multiply by the input voltage, which is V2. And this one is going to be reflected at the negative terminal, which is, we're talking about, it's going to be amplified by the negative voltage gain, RF over R1. Then at also, we are going to have this as the ratio of what is going to be there. And because these things are going to be appearing as an inverted terminal, you can have the expression changing. So this is the voltage that's going to appear there. So if we shall have our gain now, then we can have our gain now, VO being equals to VO over V2 for whatever shall be there, as being equals to minus R3 over R3 plus R2 minus RF over R1 over R1. So this is what will be amplified. This is the voltage that will be amplified. Therefore, the output voltage for the non-inverting amplifier shall be given as VO over V2 is supposed to be R3 over R3 plus R2 RF over R1 multiplied by the inverting gain, by the non-inverting gain, 1 plus RF over R. Let me use Ri so that we separate this with the over R1, 1 plus RF over R1, that's okay. So this is what shall be our gain. So let us note something concerning the input voltages. When V1 is greater than V2, when V1 is greater than V2, then the output voltage of the amplifier shall be VO is supposed to be V1 minus V2. This will now multiply the gain of the inverting, since V1 is greater than V2. Also, when V2 is greater than V1, the output shall be given by VO is supposed to be V2 minus V1 multiply by R3 over R3 plus R2. Multiply by 1 plus RF over R1.